Good morning, everyone. We are blessed today to have music. Now, as some of you know, Sharon had surgery 2 weeks ago now on her knee, and Alexis had surgery last week. So for the next few weeks, we are going to be having a variety of different musical people coming. Today, we have Patty and some of the members of the small band up with guitar, and we celebrate this. We will be having Vivian, Virginia, what's her last name again? Is it Willis? No, Noble. Virginia Noble for a few Sundays, and then by Easter, we should be welcoming Sharon back. So I ask that you hold both Alexis and Sharon is in prayer as they recover. And let us join in our greeting. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
As we arrived, we entered into this space as a separate people. But now we are the people of God gathered as one body, lighting this candle reminds us of the presence of Christ in our midst. So as I light this candle, you are invited to be seated, and then we will sing.
Open my eyes that I may see
So welcome on this sunny but chilly day. We have a few announcements that I'd like people to know. One is a reminder that fun script orders are due next Sunday, and it is the last chance before Easter. I'm pretty sure. So even if it's not, do your Easter stuff early if you want them. Oh, they would be delivered on Easter Sunday. So if you are like me and need to get things into the post office, this Sunday, or next Sunday. Also, we have that Purdy's fundraiser that went live that we talked about last time. It is up and running. If you need any help, call the office and let us know. On the topic of the office, Megan is on vacation for at least the next 7 days. So there are reduced office hours. Those are printed in your bulletin and located on the website under your e-news. I have a thank you. A thank you on this first Sunday in Lent for all of the people who put together and made the Shrove Tuesday supper happen. Those who called and cooked and cleaned and set up, a big thank you. And a big thank you to those who came and participated in community together. It was a lovely night. Are there any other announcements that people have? Well, hearing none, I invite you to join with me in our responsive call to worship. God calls us together to be God's people. Through God's word, we learn what it means to be God's people. Strive to listen and follow. In worship, we celebrate and are transformed by God's presence.
Let us grow in grace and mercy as we worship the Lord.
So let us join in singing, Open Up My Heart. If you want the words, the music, it's in the More Voices, number 79. Please be seated. And let us pray. Gracious God, we come this day seeking courage and hope for living in a reconciled community. Living together, as you imagine, is not easy. It involves being vulnerable and honest, and letting love guide all our actions. Be with us this day, teaching us and strengthening us, and walking with us on this path of right relationships. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. And we continue to pray together in this season of Lent, a season of reflection and turning back to God with our prayer of confession. Loving God, from the beginning you have said that it is not good for us to be alone. We were made to live in community. You have given us instructions for how to be your people, yet the dance of living together is difficult. There are times when we are hurt by what others have said and done, or left undone. We also confess that there are times when we have hurt others intentionally and unintentionally with our words and actions. Help us to reconcile in the ways that hold healthy boundaries and reflect your mercy and grace. This we pray in Christ's name. Amen. Hear these words and take heart. Nothing can separate us from the love of God in Jesus Christ. In the love of God, we are forgiven all of our sins by the love, commitment, and sacrifice of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Thanks be to God for reconciling us to Him. May we reflect that reconciliation in our lives. Amen. Actually, I'm not going to put that on, but I am going to move. I have my box, and I'm actually going to move, and I'm sorry, choir. It's going to be harder for you to see this. I'm sorry. We can address it after. Right now, my box is empty. Yes, my box is empty, but I'm going to put it here. Because there was a story. Well, Jesus told many stories, but he did tell us something once. He was talking to his disciples about what it means to live in the kingdom of God, and Peter, we like Peter, he always asks some wonderful questions and often trips himself up. Well, Peter, this one day, asked Jesus, how often do I have to forgive someone? And he says, how about 7 times? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Now, forgiving someone 7 times, Peter thought that was a lot. Does that sound like a lot? That's more than one hand. You need 2 hands to do it. Well, Jesus looked at Peter, as he often did, I think, with that look of, Peter, I love you. I know you're trying. And Jesus said to Peter, 70 times 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19. Oh my gosh, how often do we have to forgive? 20, 21, 22. Jesus said, God's forgiveness for you overflows, and you're encouraged to let that forgiveness be yours too. It's okay. Mommy will clean it up after. Scripture readers, you might need to be a little bit careful. Stepping on Lego is no fun, and I've created a trap. Same with you who are going for coffee. God's forgiveness overflows anything we can imagine. And though we aren't going to get it right, that is the model for us about how to live in community. As grown-ups, are going to talk a little bit more about that later. But in the meantime, let us pray. Gracious and loving God, our dear friend, we thank you for the work that you've done to make sure none of us are left suffering, holding guilt that we can't bear. Thank you for forgiving us over and over and over again as we learn what it means to be your people. Thank you and help us to share that love with those who we live with. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. So I'm going to invite our Sunday school to head on up to your lessons today. And for the rest of us, we are going to be hearing our lesson from Scripture today. We are continuing in the book of Matthew. We've skipped a few verses since last Sunday. If you were here on Ash Wednesday, you would have heard what happened just before this. And to catch everyone up, the disciples kind of had some conversation about who's going to be the greatest in the kingdom. And Jesus had said, you need to be like a little child. This is the continuing answer to Jesus' question about, or the question posed to Jesus about what it is like to be greatest in the kingdom. But our scripture readers to come forward.
The scripture this morning is taken from Matthew chapter 18, verses 15 to 35.
If another member of the church sins against you, go and point out the fault when the two of you are alone. If the member listens to you, you have regained that one. But if you are not listened to, take one or two others along with you, so that every word may be confirmed by the evidence of two or three witnesses. If the member refuses to listen to them, tell it to the church. And if the offender refuses to listen even to the church, let such a one be to you as a Gentile and a tax collector. Truly, I tell you, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Again, truly, I tell you, if two of you agree on earth about anything you ask, it will be done for you by my Father in heaven. For where two or three are gathered in my name, I am there among them.
Then Peter came and said to him,
Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as seven times?
Jesus said to him,
not seven times, but I tell you, 77 times. For this reason, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his slaves. When he began the reckoning, one who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him. And as he could not pay, his Lord ordered him to be sold, together with his wife and children and all his possessions, and payment to be made. So the slave fell on his knees before him, saying,
have patience with me, and I will pay you everything.
And out of pity for him, the lord of that slave released him and forgave him the debt. But that same slave, as he went out, came upon one of his fellow slaves who owed him 100 denarii. And seizing him by the throat, he said,
pay what you owe.
Then his fellow slave fell down and pleaded with him,
have patience with me, and I will pay you.
But he refused. Then he went and threw him into prison until he would pay the debt. When his fellow slaves saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed, and they went and reported to their lord all that had taken place. Then his lord summoned him and said to him,
you wicked slave, I forgive you all that debt because you pleaded with me. Should you not have had mercy on your fellow slave as I had mercy on you?
And in anger, His Lord handed him over to be tortured until he would pay his entire debt. So my heavenly Father will also do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother or sister from your heart.
This is the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Praise be you, O Christ.
Let us pray. Holy and gracious God, we hear these words from another time and place and ask you to speak to us through them this day. Help us to hear your will and your way for us here and now. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. There are a few things about this text that I want to sweep out of the way to start with. The first is that today's text was written by Matthew. Well, the person we attribute as Matthew, Matthew's gospel. And his community was a fledgling community. It had its struggles. It was trying to figure out how to live in a world that, well, was a bit hostile. And trying to draw the boundaries of who they were. The second piece is a textual piece. Well, if you look at your Bible, this passage that we read may have artificial headings put in place. Because our Bible, when it comes to us, originally in its original manuscript, has no paragraphs, has no chapter headings, doesn't even have periods or capitals. Well, it's all capitals. I'm very glad I'm not a biblical scholar who has to look at those original manuscripts. And I am very thankful for those people who have. When we normally read this in our Bible, it's separated into two sections. The first section is dealing with this question about how often should I forgive? First section dealing with that engage in and in between Peter and Jesus, and the second half being its own little parable. And in fact, in the lectionary that we used before turning to the narrative lectionary, this was separated into two different days. But they do talk to each other. So I'm glad that they're together. The other interesting piece, just from a perspective, is that in the text, in the very first line, when it talks about if a member sins against you, the against you isn't in those oldest manuscripts. So the question is, was it actually originally there? Or was that first part of our reading today about if a member sins, what do you do? As opposed to directly against you personally. That's my stuff that I wanted to sweep out of the way because I thought it was really interesting and could be informative as we went forward. There are scriptures in our Bible that make us feel good. There are scriptures that encourage us and make us confirm that we are on the right path. And then there are scriptures that convict us. By that I mean scriptures that hold up something in our own lives that we go, oh, maybe I am like that. It's the season of Lent. And as we start off this season of Lent with this lectionary, we are given this story about forgiving. I don't know about you, but I suspect that each and every one of us could hear those initial words and say, yeah, I haven't forgiven somebody. I'm holding on to a grudge. I'm not in right relationship. Forgiveness is part and parcel of what's happening here. When we talk about forgiveness, it's that intentional decision to give up resentment and anger, to give up that indignation that they have scorned me, they have done something wrong against me. And I think it's appropriate for us to start off Lent with forgiveness, because we're starting that journey towards Easter, to that day where we celebrate God's ultimate forgiveness of us. But there's something that we also need to remember. Theologian Douglas Hare says that unlimited forgiveness is not to be confused with sentimental tolerance of hurtful behaviors. He goes on to say that Christians are often guilty of forgiving too much and too quickly. And reconciling this call to forgiveness with that parable at the end of the slaves who do not forgive the debts of each other can be mind-boggling. How I take that parable is an extreme motivation for people to take seriously the needs of forgiveness and to pay forward the forgiveness we have gotten. I wish that that parable had a different ending, but it didn't. So let's look again at that first part. The first part of today's reading, where Peter says, how often do I need to forgive? Jesus gives the community of faith, gives us followers some really good advice. Right from the beginning, talks about regaining that member if you seek forgiveness. He reminds us that when we are in conflict, when we are hurt, when there is disagreement, that the goal isn't to win at all costs. The goal is about coming back into relationship. Jesus also gives us some really good advice about how to deal with it if we have been hurt. He tells us to first go and talk with the person. Psychologists would agree. System managers would agree that that is the best way to deal with it. But how often do we first talk to our neighbor and our best friend, and we share how much we've been hurt and how angry we are, and maybe never actually tell the person who we felt wronged by? That is one of those pinch spots where the gospel touches our lives, because so many of us don't like telling people we've been hurt, don't like that place of vulnerability, just want it to go away. Douglas Hare is right. The church is one of the places where we often try just to be nice. I'll just forget that that happened and go on with life. It's okay if they're like that. The problem is that unresolved conflict, unresolved hurt, bubbles back up in different ways. It doesn't create honest community that Jesus calls us to when we're holding grudges, when we're not in good relationship with each other, when we have false faces that we're projecting to each other. This damages the community. This damages ourselves. And so Jesus says, go deal with the person. And if that person doesn't hear you, doesn't listen, then bring two or three other people who have witnessed this. Jesus is reaching back into Deuteronomy when he says this, reaching back into those laws that were given at the very beginning around witnessing. And using that in the context of relationship. If the person doesn't hear what you are saying, authenticate it with multiple voices. There's a line in this scripture where Jesus then says, well, then get a larger group and then bring it to the church. And if then, treat that person like sinners and tax collectors. So when I say that, what do you think of? Jesus saying, well, if they don't reconcile, treat them like sinners and tax collectors. Did the automatic thought go to, well, sinners and tax collectors are not part of the community, so they're over there, so we don't have to worry about them? Is that where your mind went? Honestly? Often it does. In fact, when I first read through the scripture, I'm like, oh, that's interesting. Then I was challenged to think about, what did Jesus do to sinners and tax collectors? What did Jesus do? The community at the time was not too fond of tax collectors. But Jesus didn't cast them out. The rest of the community did, you're right, which is why we automatically think, oh, we can just put them over there. But we got to remember it's Jesus who's saying these words. And Jesus, well, he had dinner with sinners and tax collectors. He continued to reach out to them. He treated them like that lost sheep that wandered off from the 99 and followed them. In fact, our gospel today was written by Matthew. who is said to have been a tax collector. Jesus challenges us that even when we have conflict with each other, even when we are not in right relationship, that we can't just discard anyone. That we continue to seek and work towards reconciliation. That process of living in right relationship. That we continue to work within ourselves to give up the hurt and anger and resentment. This doesn't mean that we be pushovers. That doesn't mean that we allow for destructive forces or abuse or violence to continue to happen. In fact, our scripture today says that we need to be calling that out. To not allowing violence and bullying and discrimination to occur within our community, within ourselves as a people of God, and to challenge it out in the world. So much of what we deal with amongst ourselves is because behavior isn't addressed. Because we say, oh, we just need to get along and be as one mind. We think a little bit about that passage in Acts as they were all together and of one mind and life was good and happy. But actually coming together in one mind means dealing with those places where we don't agree. It involves sitting in the complicatedness of having two people who have very different thoughts and beliefs, and often neither one of them is wrong. They're different polarities on the same continuum, and finding a way to engage with each other. Often our hurts, those places where we have been wounded by others, could be addressed most easily if we did it initially. If we use the pinch method of dealing with conflict and hurt as opposed to not. The pinch method involves if you have something that gets you. If you have an interaction with someone and you feel hurt or wronged, it involves dealing with it in that initial moment, when it's just like a little pinch. But so often we want to be good Christians, so we think we need to just suppress that. And when we suppress it, it grows. And we often end up in conflict with each other again. And then we have a choice. We can deal with it when it's more of a banging crash, or we can try to suppress it again. The more that we suppress, the more that those feelings of resentment and anger grow, the bigger the problem becomes. Jesus tells us to deal with it now. When it's small, to go to the person directly and have courage and faith and know that his presence, Jesus' presence, is with us in those honest conversations. To hold out that we may be wrong, or we might not know the whole story. That doesn't mean that we haven't been hurt, but it often means that we can find clarity. That deep listening to each other is one of those places where forgiveness breaks open. Loving honesty. Conflict. Difference of opinion. occasionally having hurt feelings is not a horrible thing. Conflict and difference and challenge is the place where growth happens, where innovation happens. It allows us to engage with each other at a more deeper level, and it allows us to practice what it means to live in the kingdom, to be present, to be open, to reconcile. Sometimes reconciliation means saying no. We don't accept that kind of behavior and letting people make a choice to be or not to be. And even when one chooses to walk away from the community, we still hold out our arms saying, when you are ready, the door is open. So let us take this invitation of God, this great gift of instruction on how to be in community, honest community. Let us work with each other to develop the skills and trust we need to openly express what is going on for us. And let us model for the world what forgiveness and reconciliation truly mean. Thanks be to God for giving us these words and this challenge. Thanks be to God for giving us the way and the means. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us join in our hymn of response, Make Me a Channel of Your Peace, found on the slides, green book number 2, or also in the red book. Let us join together professing our shared faith. We are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God who has created and is creating, who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the church, to celebrate God's presence, to live with respect in creation, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus crucified and risen, our judge and our hope, in life, in death, in life beyond death. God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. Jesus, in that parable of the king who forgave the debts but that could never be repaid, and the slave who responded by withholding mercy to his own debtor, gives us an example and allows us to think about how fortunate we are that God is like the king who forgives and not like the slave. As we give today, may we do so out of the lavishness that we have been shown by God, whose forgiveness and love is beyond measure. Let our offerings be presented. And so we pray together. Gracious God, we cannot possibly repay the debt we owe you for all you have given us. We are grateful that you do not even ask us to try. You do, however, invite us to participate in a redeemed life with you. Therefore, we offer now what we can, that the church may shine thereof and we are richly blessed. Accept the financial gifts given today, those received in the office through PAR and e-transfer, and combine them with the gifts of our time and talent for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Please be seated. Let us pray. We come before you, O God, trusting in the promise of Jesus' unending life. We pray this day for the church, the world, and all who are in need. Loving God, you have taught us to walk in your way of mercy and peace. Teach us to forgive, that we might be better and better serve our siblings in Christ. Merciful God, hear our prayer. Make us intentional stewards of your awesome creation. We look and we see this planet, which suffers from great imbalance. We pray that you heal the planet, so that it might bring forth abundant life for generations to come. Merciful God, hear our prayer. As we walk together this Lenten journey, give us humility to see where we have harmed others. Free us from shame, that we might put right the wrongs, and know that no matter what, your love for us is sure. Merciful God. Holy and gracious God. So often our world is found in conflict, where power and struggle to survive clash. Gracious God. Holy One, As we come and have passed the anniversary of the conflict in the Ukraine, we pray, O Holy One, for your Spirit to break open hearts that are hard. We pray for your protection on those who are just seeking to live. We pray for an end to that conflict and all of the others in this world. Merciful God, pour your healing upon all who are suffering in body, mind, and spirit. Heal the hurts of our sin and restore us to our wholeness. We pray this day. We pray this day especially for Sharon and Alexis, for Alice, for Dean's continued journey, for all those who are known only to you. Merciful God, give us hearts of grace towards this people of this world, and help us to be at action, your love in action, in the places of pain and hurt. Give us courage to stand up when we see injustice. Unbind our mouths. Break open our hearts, that we may be part of your reconciliation, bringing together this whole human family in the name of love. Merciful God, loving and gracious God, we remember those this day who are grieving, those who have had loved ones die with things left unsaid and undone. We pray for release and comfort in knowing that in you nothing is lost. We give thanks also for the opportunity we had yesterday or on Friday to remember Vernon and to celebrate his life. May we continue to live each moment of our lives with integrity and passion. Merciful God, with gratitude, we remember all that you have taught us, all the blessings you have given us, and so we say thank you, merciful God. We join these prayers of our community with the prayer that Jesus taught us, praying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. There was one announcement I forgot to make at the beginning of the service, and I realized it the first time I sat down. The flowers here were left by the Greens after the service yesterday, and we give thanks for Vernon's witness and for the beauty that is given to this time and place. And we give thanks again to these wonderful music makers, because I was a little bit worried we'd have to sing a cappella for the next couple weeks, and so I am incredibly grateful. No, don't roll your eyes, I'm serious. You might not think that it's great, but it is. We are so grateful. And so one of the things that happened is that Patty was like, told me, these are the list of songs that I know. You make it work. So we are going to be singing some hymns in the next couple days that aren't hymns in our hymn book, such as the one right now, Put Your Hand in the Hand. And so let us, as we continue this faith journey, to put our hand into God's hand, into Christ's hand. But if you put it there, you're hiding the microphone. There we go. Maybe. They didn't want me to point that out. Let us join in following Patty as we join in this hymn. Put your hand up. May this Lenten journey continue. May we look at ourselves with humility and with grace. May we see those places where we have hurt others and go seeking to reconcile. May we take those places that we have been hurt and hold them up to the light of God and claim them and name them. That God may mend all that is broken, and let us be a community in which care and love, forgiveness and mercy run wild. So go now, forgiven to forgive, knowing that the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit is with you always, every step you take. Amen. Let's sing our choral closing. A new song. I forgot to tell everyone we're only singing the love verse. That would be the first one. Where in the hymn book I think it says peace to start with. You got choices. So how about we try that one more time just because it was new. Are you okay with that, Patty? And you're going to have to play it next week anyway, so. On that. We'll all work on that. But yay! We got the words out this time, which is good. God be with you all. Join us for coffee and conversation, or make sure you're bundled up if you're leaving. It's okay, Patty. It's all good. It is a blessing that you are here. And you. And all of you. Now I feel like Mr. Rogers.